Hello, the name is Bond. James Bond. Yeah, no, that was really bad Sean Connery, huh? Spyware and backdoors. Now, typically we talk about spyware and we have this vision that comes up in our minds about stupid users or, excuse me, uneducated users who install things like grandma or, in my case, nieces and nephews, who install products without their knowledge that another piece of software is being installed. Spyware, again, is typically installed by us. When you download a free product, typically the manufacturer wants to know how you're running that product, or maybe they are going to make money. In fact, I think it's kind of funny. Last time that I installed Java, during the installation, if I hadn't hit the advanced button, I would have also installed some additional toolbars and software that I'm sure that Oracle gets paid for. Last time I checked, I didn't think Oracle was hurting for money. Huh. And when it comes to spyware, technically, even your operating system is going to be monitoring things like your keystrokes. A real-world example of legitimate spyware would be Microsoft. We've all seen the little pop-up that says, hey, would you like to report this to Microsoft? And typically, the information that's transmitted to Microsoft or to the vendor is strictly about that particular application. But again, you got to remember, attackers are using the same technology to provide them with possibly screenshots. Maybe we'll even capture our authentication credentials as you type them in. We might even capture emails or fire up and record information when we type in something on a web form. And again, I'll use Google as an example since they're the big boy on the block and they give, quote, everything away for free. A lot of it is they're trying to capture habits. Well, think of that from the attacker's perspective. Could he not profile you a little bit better if he understood your habits?
What kind of habits, Dale?
That you wash your hands after going to the restroom. No, I'm kidding. Maybe some of the habits that we're capturing could be, hey, he uses this password when it comes to banking sites, or he uses this password when it comes to his social networking sites, or he typically is using just a variation of a specific password. Again, if I'm capturing both screenshots and keystrokes, I can start to capture habits. But even on my Android phone, I download a free game to play, they're capturing my habits. How long is he playing the game? And I mentioned this back in the Understanding Ethical Hacking course. I understand that this stuff is taking place. When I go to install an application on my tablet, my phone, my computer, do I sit down and read the EULA? That would be the user license agreement. No, I don't. But I understand the overall gist of it, and that is, one, you don't own the software, and two, we're going to collect information about you. And I accept that as a risk, but I only accept that as a risk from legitimate software companies. Now, let me ask you a question. Who's spying on us? Well, we've talked about marketing companies as well as software vendors, but yes, organized crime.
I'm going to make him an offer. He can't refuse.
I know we typically think of organized crime and we're thinking, the mob, Dale. But trust me, big money is being made in hacking and organized crime. It's out there. Side note here, if you're a member of organized crime, my name is Fred Johnson, and I have nothing but total respect for you and your business. And I'm not going to ask you about your business, okay? Personally, I got taken by a Russian organized crime ring. We'll just say that that's a story for another time. Online attackers. Hopefully I've drilled this into your brain enough here. Please do yourself a favor and make sure that all the software installed on your systems is legit. And it's not just software. You're going to see when it comes to spyware, I can execute the spyware even if you're just streaming a movie or listening to a song. And believe it or not, someone else who may be spying on you could be trusted insiders or people who work within your organization. So my wife works for a extremely large electronics department store that you could say has buys that are really the best. That was cryptic, wasn't it? But this particular company goes through and utilizes some nifty tools that tells them what software is installed on a machine, what hardware is in the machine, as well as gives them some usage information. They're actually using a product called System Center Configuration Manager. And a trusted insider would be just that. We're putting a piece of software on so we can monitor our resources. So what are the types of spyware?
GDL, there's the spyware that you install on your desktop, and that's it.
No, it's not. It's the most typical. This type of spyware is typically installed as you're installing an application. For example, let's say I go off and I download a copy of, WinZip. And during the installation, if I just hit next, which they're hoping I do, I might actually install a new toolbar. And that toolbar in Internet Explorer is going to track some of my activities. Now, again, think of this from the attacker's perspective. Let's say that a new version of Photoshop comes out. I go through as an attacker and crack that product, put in my own piece of spyware so that when they install the application, my spyware gets installed. And I'm going to make sure that it's hidden so they can't see it running. Yes, I can hide it from your task manager, folks. We also have spyware that comes across via video. Now, I'm not talking about YouTube. However, I'm pretty sure that YouTube does monitor what videos you're watching on their channel. That would be legitimate, right? Because, again, you may think it's free. It's really not. But I had a nephew who brought me his computer once and said, "Hey, Dale, it's running really slow and sluggish." By the way, that's one of your symptoms, that you've got some spyware. And as I'm going through and looking at it, I'm like seeing all these programs that are firing up in the startup section. And as I'm talking to him, he starts to tell me about how he found this really cool website where he can stream movies that are still in the theater for free. Okay, there's that free word again. Folks, nothing is free. I don't care if you're streaming. And by the way, guess what? I'm sure Netflix is spying on you when you're watching videos from their service. But I'm not worried about that. I'm more worried about someone coming to my house. This same nephew tried to pull up the webpage to show me, and I was like, slow-mo, no, and quickly unplugged the network cable because I know what's out there. There's also spyware for printing. Say what, Dale? Printing? Yeah, how about this? How about if I load a piece of spyware and everything you print, I get a copy of it, please? Dun, dun, dun. Think about that one for a second. What do you print?
Just Word documents.
Okay, I'm sure you've never printed tax forms, medical records, or better yet, let's say your doctor gets a piece of spyware on his machine because your doctor's receptionist thinks that every time a pop-up comes up saying you need to install this piece of software because they're going to inappropriate or websites that just are malicious in nature, we install a piece of spyware and get a copy of every single document printed. There's also USB-based spyware. So I've got this piece of software that I show as kind of a proof of concept here. It's used quite often out there. But I always have students come up to me and say, "Hey, Dale, is there a way you can give me a copy of this white paper? Or can you give me a copy of these virtual machines?" I'm like, "Yeah, just bring me up a USB drive." And they bring me up a USB drive and I plug it in. And I have a little program that as I'm copying files to their USB drive, I'm also injecting spyware on their USB drive. So that when they plug it into their system, it injects all silently without their knowledge. It'll also go through and just download everything on their USB drive to my machine as well. There's also spyware that's injected in audio. There is no such thing, folks, as free MP3s. Again, let's think about both sides, both the legitimate reasons for spyware and the dark side of the force with spyware. Let's say you have an account with Spotify or with Google or Google Music. I guarantee those companies are monitoring and seeing what you're doing with their audio files, how many machines you've installed it on, how many times you've listened to it. Some of these are done with cookies, I understand that, but if you're installing any type of application or plugin into your web browsers, hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, I guarantee you're getting some type of tracking software. Well, again, if I want to go through and get some spyware on your machine, I'm going to get the latest, let's see, I'm a big Collective Soul fan. No, none of my passwords deal with Collective Soul. But maybe they've got a new album coming out. I'll go through, rip it, and make it so if somebody downloads it, because I'll post it on the torrent sites, and if anybody downloads it and starts to play the music, my spyware kicks in. And of course, there's also even spyware this is another typical one besides the desktop one, and that is spyware that's distributed via email and obviously the internet. We've talked about malicious websites. And I've seen them. I've gone to a website. No, it's probably not happening on the big boys, you know, like Apple or Google or Microsoft. But, you know, you get a Oswald Cobblepot's driver download page Oh, and that would be another type, by the way. I actually got a piece of spyware via a driver. Technically, I think actually it was a backdoor. I'll have to think about that story again. But people get emails saying, hey, this is the IRS. We're going to start filing charges against you because of your tax forms. Click here, and you click on the link, or the user clicks on the links, goes to a site, or executes a script that's malicious in nature. And guys and gals, don't think for a second that this is limited to just to our PCs. This is exploding on the mobile platform. One of the things that I do when I'm going to install an application on my phone, again, I know that there's going to be something there to track what I'm doing, but I look at the permissions to see what it is they need access to. Let me tell you something. If it's a game, I don't care how cool the game is, and it wants access to my contacts, that's not going on my device. So make sure you review the permissions of applications. And most of the big vendors require that, whether you're getting it from the iTunes store or whether you're getting it from the App Store from Google or from Amazon. Those I would consider somewhat trusted sources. Be very careful about downloading software or applications from different repositories out there. I don't care if it's the coolest thing ever. In fact, that's part of the social engineering aspect of hacking. I'm counting on the fact that you want this so stinking bad that you're willing to justify and jump through some hoops and maybe install a piece of software that's going to help me pwn you.